Hello, little girls and girlettes, and welcome to another fine, festivious season of the October month of Spook, hosted by your host, Edgy Chappie. Today we take a look at some of the most evil creatures to ever plague the D&D multiverse, the Demons of the Abyss. I am going to talk about what makes a demon, their general livelihood, and I'll even go over the various demon lords that have made claim to the various evils of the world. As always, keep in mind that a lot of this is just my opinion, and my opinion, as always, is much more important than yours because my opinion is coming through a microphone. And just real quick, I want to give a brief shout out to my new patrons this month. Isabel Vaffers, Alex, Michael Fong, Timofik, Dan Vosselman, Trainer Blue 192, Alex Kuckzoon, Derek Schwind, Wesley. Thank you for pledging to my Patreon. I love you. Don't get possessed by demons.
But with that out of the way, let's begin. So, demons in the context of D&D are categorized as part of the fiend monster type, and they are some of the baddest boys you could ever meet. Demons aren't the conniving trickster imps that you might be picturing, those are devils. Instead, demons are the hulking monsters, the brutes, the beasts that show up, smash everything in sight, and smash it again to make sure it's smashed. They're arrogant and powerful, each one believing that they are the epitome of swole, and their one mindless driving purpose is to twist and desecrate the world that they're in into the deep abyss that they come from. Hell, the whole reason why they like to go into the nine hells isn't because of some grand gamer plot, it's because that's where the best things to punch live. The general MO of Demon is to spawn into a server and then just start griefing everything they can find. Forests will burn, houses will be blasted apart, and Minecraft girlfriends will be stolen in the night and carried off into the nether to be turned into ghasts. And that means that there is absolutely no reason for anybody to try to bring them into the material world ever. What are you doing? Summoning demons? What? Can you be so stupid? They don't make deals. You don't control demons. The most you can do is conjure up a demon and then keep yourself in a bubble that demon has to unwrap before getting into your moist, gooey center. To understand why those who consort with demons are doomed to failure, you have to understand the distinct difference between a demon and a devil, because devils make deals, and demons only press F to pay respects, with respects being to your face and their only payment is pain. Demons live their lives grown out of the ichor of the abyss with a pre-understood knowledge that Ghost is the best band in the world, Ohio is a vacation spot, and Doom is a cautionary tale of why we don't give shotguns to humans. Whether they were crafted out of bile, flies, or Loth's own demon web, no two demons are created equal, and each one thinks that it is the most unequal as they start their diseased lives in the madness of the pits, navigating the ever-changing layers that bear a resemblance to the nonsense and pants of Limbo or Pandemonium, until you realize that they aren't nearly as random, but they are instead shifted to fit the needs and whims of the mighty demon lords that rule the plains of the abyss. From there, a demon may either be summoned into the material world by an idiot, or it could simply crawl its way out of the depths of its own hell, with its wild mind now stuck in a grossly clean and eerily unfamiliar territory. Its only solution is to start rending and tearing at everything, both consciously and subconsciously warping the world to pull it closer into the abyss. This is the reason why we don't summon demons. Summoning one demon is bad, but worse is letting that demon stay in the world to fester, because once a demon has started to eat away at the barrier between the material plane and the abyss, then we're all kinds of ducked. See, the infection of an area by those with demonish influences goes like this. Whether it be summoned or brought into the material world by its own hands or the hands of a demon lord, that demon will start poisoning the world around it like a tumor. This is phase one. Over time, the infection will spread across the area that demon prowls, killing the houses, burning the water, and poisoning the peasants, and for the most part, this is easy to deal with. Just hire some plucky adventurers to go deal with it, and once it's dead, the natural world will do its thing and go back to the way it was. But if that demon survives for a long enough time, then that's when phase two arrives. Like a cyst, the abyssal influence will build up in the location of the demon's prowling grounds until it eventually pops and rips open a portal to the abyss. From there, any demon that happened to be enjoying a nice fireside brunch when the portal opens up next to them can just come right through and grow the problem exponentially. Luckily, this still isn't the worst thing in the world, since the location that the portal opens up in is completely random, so it's more than likely just gonna spawn in a demon's currently unused summer home, or maybe it'll just spawn so high in the air that's a pain to get to at all. Of course, if the portal is found, then the demons will start letting all the other demons know about it, because demons love going through portals. Also, the infection at this stage is still very haphazard. The demons may tell each other where the portal is, but once they're on the other side, they could give a flump about their comrades, since they have a whole new playground to piss in. And if enough of the demons are killed, then the portal will get smaller and smaller until it just blips out of existence and things go back to phase one. Now, should that portal not be dealt with, and should the demons not be killed properly so that their cooties don't spread, then that's when we have a problem. If the corruption has gone on for long enough to make it to phase three, then the material world will stop considering it an invasion and just start to accept the corruption as the new normal, which is very bad. The infection expands out rapidly, and demons start to form their own adventuring parties to go rid the world of good vibes, and the portal to the abyss becomes permanent without major magical intervention. Even if the forces of good come together and clean out the entire infected area, which I should tell you value is already a very difficult thing to do, then the area will have already been too far gone for far too long, and it will always be susceptible to another demon just finding the portal and wandering through it. But all of that is playground antics compared to a demon infestation that makes it to phase 4, the final form. With the portal continuing to spam demons like an overzealous Zerg player, the demonic plague will grow and grow until it eventually catches the attention of the mighty demon lords of the Abyss. After the initial, oh, what's this? The demon lords will either fight over the property of the mighty Hole of Destiny, or they may decide to be total bros and pound it one at a time. But in either case, the demon lord makes its way into the material plane and wreaks absolute havoc. Its armies cascade out of the portal and march upon the poor souls that now live in fear of a demon knocking on their door asking for infernal sugar. The only hope for survival at this point rests in the hands of 3 to 5 of the pluckiest, most attitude-driven adventurers in the entire world to push back the demon lord and its armies and scatter all of the demons back from which they came. This is practically impossible to accomplish, and failure means that the demon lord or lords burn their existence into the very fabric of the world, and over time this material plane is terraformed into just a new layer of the infinite abyss, doomed to be forgotten by those who will never even know its name. But the demon lords themselves are the ones who call the shots and guide their spawn in a never-ending quest to attain more power and influence among the cosmos, so it should serve you well to know their names and what their whole deal is, so that you too can serve their purposes and welcome our new abyssal overlords. Baphomet, the Horned King, is the closest physical representation of the devil in Christian mythology, and he is pretty much the easiest to understand. If you serve the goat, you are good. If you do not serve the goat, you are bad, which is also good because it means that you get to be killed by the bad guys, which is very good, but bad for you. Baphomet represents the predator that hunts its prey, and so both he and his followers enjoy setting up elaborate systems in which their target will run around, fruitlessly trying to get out of the bad place, never to succeed because the cage that they're in is on a treadmill, and the treadmill is full of spikes. Also, please don't mistake Baphomet, the demon lord of the hunt, with the similarly named Bahamut, the silver god of dragonkind, because they are very different, and every time someone makes that mistake, a DM loses his wings. Demogorgon,
no, not that one,
is perhaps the strongest demon lord in terms of pure physical thickness, and his twin heads give him all the brain power of a guy with two heads, and yet somehow his plans always just boil down to throw large amounts of demons at it until the problem goes away. His most clever feature is that anyone that gazes upon his demonic symbol are charmed to do his bidding, and his ultimate goal is to wipe out literally 100% of non-Demogorgon life so that he can relax, knowing that everyone in the world is happy. Thras Urblu is a demon lord so sneaky and deceptive that his name should be spelled like this. His whole deal is that he wants to make people go insane through paranoia and endless mind games, and so the only people who serve him willingly are assholes with an equal penchant for just as planned. One of my favorite demon lords is Grazit, the lord of pleasure and indulgence that is sort of opening my eyes to a pattern that may or may not definitely be there. Grazit is a trickster that breaks the mold of demonism by not just being an overwhelming force of nature that takes over lands through sheer force of will, but also being pretty much the only devil to think, you know what, devil work is dumb, and skedaddle to the other end of the blood war so that he can be debaucherous without Daddy Asmodeus disapproving of his lifestyle. Jubilex is the Jello Shot of Ultimate Destiny that is the ooze from which all oozes are made. Honestly, Jubilex is less of a demon lord and is more of just a really, really, really big ooze that nobody can kill or convince to leave the Abyss, so they just gave him a crown, which he ate, and do their best not to invite him to demon parties. Orcus is the evil prince of undead that all you necromancers pay a tithe to whenever you get Dem Bones or Adeline. Honestly, he really is a benevolent creature that saw the cries of millennials screaming that they want to die and thinking, hey, I can help with that. Yinagu is the Null King of Vorin Furries, and I refuse to talk about him further. Finally, Zugtmoy is the Demon Queen of Plants, and she uses these plants to make more plants and turn other people into plants, and come on guys, why don't you just become a fern? Ferns are nice!
Fern it up, bitch!
Anyway, her main method of gaining followers is to infect mortals with spores that'll make them like her, and then those infected mushrooms can go around and breathe on other people until everyone can see the infected mushroom in the sky and know that it is indeed your giant mushy mushy friend. But that'll about do it! I hope you enjoyed this video. Leave a like, comment, subscribe, join my Discord, join my Twitter. Please, please, don't summon a demon, and maybe support me on Patreon so that when the demons do finally rise up, gamers, I can afford all the infernal sugar they can handle. But yeah, Davvy out.